Hello everyone, welcome to Vyas Edification. In this session we are going to discuss NCERT and exercise solutions as well as the detailed explanation of all the questions related to chapter number 5, Laws of Motion of class 11th. Clear? So in this lecture you will find the detailed discussion of each and every question as well as all the concept behind that question. Clear? So for each question, and if you have any doubt related to end exercise solutions, so please watch this video and definitely you will get benefited. Clear? So now concentrate on a screen. We are going to discuss each and every question. So let's start. Now dear student, we are going to discuss question number 5.1. And in this question it is given to you, give the magnitude and direction of net force acting on. Clear? So actually five different situations are given to you and you have to find what is net force acting on that particular body as well as what is direction of that net force. Clear? So now we are going to discuss each and every case one by one. Clear? So concentrate on the screen. So now let's suppose if I talk about part number A. In this question it is given to you a drop of rain falling down with a constant speed. So in this question it is, let's suppose here we have a raindrop. Actually we know the raindrop is always spherical one, and let's suppose this raindrop is actually falling with constant velocity. It is given in this question. Clear to you? Or we can say it is going with a constant speed. Now we have to find what is net force acting. So when this raindrop is going with a constant speed, it means we can say acceleration of this body, or we can say acceleration of this raindrop is equal to zero, because we know acceleration is given by dv by dt. Clear? So when acceleration is equal to dv by dt, we can say when speed is zero, speed is constant, at that time we can say acceleration is equal to 0 meter per second square. Clear? So we can write like this. Let's suppose we know mass of a raindrop. So we can say this is mass into acceleration. Acceleration is 0. So we can see net force, this is acting, this is equal to 0 Newton. Clear to you? So we can say net force acting on this raindrop, it is equal to 0. Now you can say, sir, if this is a raindrop, definitely here and mg force also acting here. Definitely, my dear student, if we talk about different forces, this is acting on this raindrop. Definitely we can say, number one, gravitational force is acting. Now you can say, sir, if gravitational force is acting, how can we say net force is equal to zero? Actually, we can say gravitational force acting on raindrop is balanced by, we can say, upthrust and the viscous drag that is acting on that body. Clear? It balanced by we can say upthrust. Upthrust is also known as buoyant force. Clear? And we can say viscous drag. Clear to everyone? It means we can say weight due to self weight, or we can say self weight is acting in the vertically downward direction. Because this body is actually moving under a fluid, we can assume air as a fluid. So we can say upthrust is acting in an upward direction. Clear? And definitely, because this raindrop is having certain velocity, so we can say according to Stokes law, F equal to 6 pi neta rv. So viscous drag, or we can say viscous force, also come into picture, and it always act in a vertical upward direction. Clear? So gravitational force is balanced by viscous drag and upthrust. Clear? And we can say net force on this raindrop is zero, and we can say this will move with the constant velocity. Clear to everyone? So what is net force in this case? We can say net force we have 0 Newton, and when we have net force 0, it means we cannot say about direction. Clear? So this is all about part number A. Clear? Now if I talk about part number B, a cork of mass 10 gram floating on water. So let's suppose I am taking here one example. Let's suppose I am having this container. Clear? And let's suppose in this container, I can say cork is floating at this point. Let's suppose this is cork. Clear? So we can see when this is cork, we can see weight of the cork is acting, this is W. and definitely because this is submerged, or we can say it is floating on a fluid, or we can say on a water, definitely a buoyant force is also acting in an upward direction. Clear? Because this cork is floating, it means we can say net force acting on this cork, this is equal to zero. Clear? Or we can say when F net is equal to zero, so there is no worth to talk about direction. Clear? So directly we can say weight of that cork is balanced by upthrust or the buoyant force acting on this cork. Clear everyone? So again we can say there is no any force acting on a cork in situation number B. Clear? Now if I talk about number C. Clear? So number C means I can say a kite skillfully held stationary in a sky. Now actually we know kite, it should be like this. Almost it will be like this. Clear? So let's suppose it is connected with a string here. And let's suppose skillfully we are placing this kite stationary in an atmosphere. Clear? So we can see at the time, I can see because this is at rest in a sky, we can see force acting by air, it is equal to, or we can say it is balanced by tension force, this is acting in this thread. Yes or no? So we can say this is balanced by tension acting in a thread. Clear to everyone? Yes. So now what is value of net force acting on this thread? We can say here, we can say net force is equal to 0 newton. Clear everyone? Now we are going to discuss part number D. In this question it is given a car moving with a constant velocity on a rough road. Clear? Again you can observe this situation. In this situation car is going with a constant velocity. Constant velocity means again we can say net acceleration, this is equal to 0, or we can say net force, this is acting on a car, this is 0. Now you can say, sir, definitely in a car we have an engine, and we can say engine is exerted a force on the car. Definitely you are right, but at that time we can say the force exerted by engine, this is balanced by the friction force acting between tire and the surface. Clear? And we can say net force acting on the car, this is 0. Clear? So we can say car is moving here with constant velocity. Clear to everyone? So this is all about part number D. If we talk about part number E, in part number E it is given to you a high speed electron in space far from all material object and free from electric and magnetic field. Now listen carefully. Let's suppose we have here a charged particle. Let's suppose I am having here charged particle, and in this question it is given this is electron. This electron is having high speed. Clear? It is far from all material object. It means we can say there is no gravitational force acting on this charged particle, and it is also away from electric and magnetic field. So definitely we can say there is no electric force and no magnetic force is acting on this charged particle. Clear? Actually we know when a charged particle is placed in an electric field, we can say F equal to QE act on that body or on the charged particle. And we also know if this charged particle is in motion, force acting in a magnetic field, this is given by QV cross B. Clear everyone? So from here we can say because electric field and magnetic field both are absent, it means we can say there is no force acting on this electron. Clear? It means this electron will move with a constant velocity, and we can say acceleration, we can say this is equal to 0. When acceleration is 0, it means we can say net force, this is equal to 0 newton. Clear everyone? So this is all about all these 5 parts. So this is all about this question. Now dear student, we are going to discuss question number 5.2, and in this question it is given to you a pebble of mass 0.05 kilogram is thrown in vertically upward direction. Give the direction and magnitude of the net force acting on the pebble. Clear? So now listen carefully. Now we can see, let's suppose if we talk about a pebble, so let's suppose here we have this pebble. Clear? And a pebble of mass 0.05 kg. So I can say this is 0.05 kilogram. Clear? It is thrown vertically upward. So let's suppose initial velocity I am taking u. Give the direction and magnitude of a force acting on this pebble. Fine. During its upward motion. Clear? So let's suppose first, if I am talking about part number A, Let's suppose this pebble is going in an upward direction. Clear? So definitely we can see acceleration due to gravity, this always act in a downward direction. Clear? I am taking upward direction positive, so automatically this becomes negative. Clear? So if I write here force, I can say force is acting, this is equal to minus times of mg. Clear? This minus sign is indicating force is acting in vertically downward direction. Clear? Now, so our objective in this question is to calculate magnitude. I can say magnitude in this case we have F equal to mg. Clear? And what about direction? I can say direction of a force acting, this is vertically downward direction. Vertically downward. Clear to everyone? Yes. Now if I talk about part number B, in part number B, we have to find net force acting on this pebble during its downward motion. So let's suppose first pebble is going in an upward direction. Clear? At a certain height, its velocity becomes zero, and again that pebble is going in a downward direction. Clear? It means we can say, let's suppose this is position of a pebble. In this time, pebble is going actually in a downward direction, let's suppose with certain velocity u. Clear? Or let's suppose at any instant velocity we have u. Clear? And definitely we can say acceleration is acting in vertically downward direction. This is g meter per second square. Clear? So now if we talk about magnitude of force, I can say this is equal to again mg. And what is direction of this force? I can say this is equal to vertically downward direction. Vertically downward direction. Vertically downward direction. Clear to everyone? So again we have the same answer. Now third part is given to you. At the highest point where it's when it is momentarily at rest. So we are actually throwing a pebble with a certain velocity. Let's suppose we are throwing that pebble from this position. Clear? And let's suppose initial velocity we have u. It is reaches up to certain height. Let's suppose at this point its velocity becomes zero. Now we know, because this pebble is moving under the influence of gravity, at maximum height its velocity becomes zero. But what about acceleration? Acceleration always act on this pebble. This is equal to a equal to minus g meter per second square. If I am taken upward direction positive. Clear? It means we can say at maximum height, I can see net force acting on this pebble. This is given by mg. This is magnitude. And what about the direction of acceleration or direction of a force? Direction of a force, we can see, again we have, this is vertically downward direction. Vertically downward direction. Clear everyone? Yes. Now if I talk about last part, do your answer changes if pebble was thrown at an angle 45 degree with horizontal direction? Listen carefully. Actually now this is a case of a projectile motion. Clear? So let's suppose we have a pebble. This is a pebble, initial velocity is u. Let's suppose we are throwing this pebble at an angle 45 degree. Clear? Definitely we know under the influence of gravity it will move in a parabolic path. But important part is here, if you observe this pebble for a different position, if we talk about this position and this position, clear? So we know acceleration due to gravity always acting here in a vertically downward direction. Clear to you? Clear? Here you can see, yes, definitely tangential velocity, it will be changed. Clear? Or you can also understand like this, if we talk about horizontal velocity, this is u cos 45 and this one is u sin 45. Clear? So from here you can say only vertical component of velocity will be changed, horizontal velocity remain constant. So in projectile motion, when we have horizontal component of velocity remain constant, it means there is no acceleration in x direction. Clear? And it means we can say the acceleration that always act only in a vertical direction. Clear? It means I can say again, if we talk about net force acting, this is having magnitude mg. And what about direction? Direction, we can say this is vertically downward. Vertically downward. So now you can say in each and every case we are getting same answer. Clear? So whatever may be the type of a motion, acceleration due to gravity always act in downward direction. So net force due to gravitational force always acting in downward direction. This situation may change if there is a one force in a horizontal direction, but it is not given in this situation that there is a force is acting in a horizontal direction. It is not given. Clear? So this is all about this question. Clear? Now we are going to discuss question number 5.3. And in this question, it is given to you, give the magnitude and direction of net force acting on a stone of mass 0.1 kg. Clear? So a stone is given to you having mass 0.1 kg. Clear? This is given to you. Now we have to find magnitude and direction of a force, number A part, just after it is dropped from window of a stationary train. Clear? So now listen carefully. First situation, if we talk about situation number A, in this situation it is given to you mass of a stone, this is 0.1 kilogram. Clear? This is given. We have to find magnitude and direction of net force just after it is dropped from window of a stationary train. This is important. So let's suppose we can say this is a train. Clear? And let's suppose we are dropping a stone from this window. Clear? Now we can say because this train is at rest, as we are dropping this stone from a window of a train, we can say initial velocity we have, this is zero. Yes or no? Now we can say as soon as we drop this stone, acceleration due to gravity, this is acting on this body in vertically downward direction. Clear? So can we calculate here value of force? Yes. This is equal to mg only. Clear? Because train is stationary. So we can say mass of that stone is given 0.1 multiply, let's suppose this is 10. Acceleration due to gravity we have 10. So we can say this is equal to 1 newton. Clear? So force, this is acting on this stone when we are dropping this stone from stationary train, we can say this is equal to 1 newton. Clear to everyone? Done. Now if I talk about part number B, in this situation it is given. Now let's suppose train is running at a constant velocity, that is 36 km/h. It means if I talk about velocity of a train, I can say 36 × 5/18, and this should be equal to 10 m/s. So train is moving with a constant velocity 10 m/s, but after that I am dropping a stone from a window. So you can analyze this given situation. Let's suppose this train is moving with a constant velocity 10 m/s. Clear? So definitely we can say because this velocity is constant, so there is no acceleration acting in an horizontal direction. Clear? But what will happen when we drop a stone from the window of this train? We can say as soon as we drop this stone, at that time you can see only the acceleration due to gravity acting, this is in a vertically downward direction. Clear? Because there is no acceleration is acting in horizontal direction. So we can say here force, this is given by mass into acceleration, and this force is acting in vertical downward direction. So what is value of mass? Mass of this stone is given 0.1 kg. So 0.1 multiply 10. Again we are getting net force acting on this stone. This is equal to 1 newton. Clear? Yes. Now let's suppose again situation changes. Now this time it is given just after it is dropped from window of a train accelerating with 1 m/s². Now let's suppose we have a train. This train is going in a horizontal direction. Now it is given this is 1 m/s². Now let's suppose because this stone is in our hand and we are sitting in a train. Clear? At that time I can say me, stone, as well as all the passenger that is sitting inside train, all are having acceleration 1 m/s². Clear? But what will happen as I just drop a stone? At that time as I just drop the stone, we can see only the force that is acting on that stone is acceleration due to gravity. Yes or no? It means we can say as I drop stone, we can see only force that is acting here, I can see F equal to mg. Clear? So now you can say, sir, why acceleration is not acting in horizontal direction, because that acceleration is acting as till we can say stone is in a train. As the stone detaches from a train, this acceleration becomes zero, and we can see now only the force is acting in a vertically downward direction. So mass is given 0.1 multiply 10, and this is equal to 1 Newton. Clear? Now we are going to discuss last situation. In last situation, it is given, let's suppose stone is lying on the floor of a train which is accelerating with 1 meter per second square. Fine. The stone being at rest relative to the train. Fine. So now we are not drawing this stone from the window of a train. Now we are saying, let's suppose this stone is placed inside this train. Now we have to find what is the net force acting on this stone. So definitely when the stone is inside a train, it will actually, if I observe from a ground, at that time I can say this stone is moving with the same acceleration as the train is moving. Clear? And let's suppose I am an observer and I am inside this train. It means if I am observing this stone with non-inertial frame, at that time I can say that net force this is acting on this stone is zero. Clear? So actually it depends on a frame of reference. Clear? So if we talk about inertial frame, or let's suppose if we are observing from a ground, at that time I can say net force this is acting on this stone, this is mass into acceleration, this is 0.1, and because it is given acceleration of a train, we have 1 meter per second square. So we can say this is equal to 0.1 Newton. Clear? But let's suppose observer is situated on the, inside this train. At this time we can say, if we are talking about non-inertial frame, or let's suppose if we are talking about, or if we are talking with reference to a observer that is situated inside this train, we can say we will observe there is no net force this is acting on this stone. Clear? At that time you can say net force this is acting on this stone, this is zero. Clear? So it depends on a frame of reference from where you are observing this motion. Clear? So this is all about this question. Clear to everyone? Now dear student, we are going to solve this question, question number 5.4. and in this question it is given to you, one end of a string of length L is connected to a particle having mass m and the other to a small peg on a smooth horizontal table. This is given to you. If the particle move in a circle with speed v, then net force on the particle that is acting, it is towards the center. Clear? So first let us try to analyze this given situation. Let's suppose we have a horizontal table. So let's suppose if I am talking about this horizontal table. So let's suppose this is a horizontal table. I am saying this is a horizontal table. Clear? Let's suppose this is a circle in which this particle is actually rotating. We can say, let's suppose here we have a center, and let's suppose if I place here one peg, yes, and we can say one end of the string, it is connected to a mass m. Clear? This is given to you. Length of this string is given, that is L. Clear? Now let's suppose this stone, or we can say this mass is actually rotating in a circle with a speed v. Clear? So let's suppose at any instant, let's suppose velocity in this direction. Now we know if any particle or any object that is rotating in a circular path, we can see a force that is acting towards the center along the radius, that is known as centripetal force. Clear? And now we know, because this is a string, so definitely a tension force will act here. Clear? Now you can say, sir, is there any difference between tension force and centripetal force? So my dear student, any force that is acting towards the center along the radius, that is known as tension. Clear everyone? So now we can see at this position tension force is acting towards center along radius. Now let's suppose you can say, sir, let's suppose this stone come to this position, what will happen? So I can see at that time velocity is in this direction and centripetal force is acting in this direction, that is tension T. Clear? We can say whenever we are saying centripetal force is acting towards the center along the radius, it means we are talking from the inertial frame of reference. Clear? But let's suppose if I put observer on this mass, at the time you can say that you will feel no net force that is acting on this mass. Why? Because as soon as we are talking about non-inertial frame, at the time a centrifugal force will act in an outward direction. Clear to you? So it means you can don't get confused. If you are observing from inertial frame, always observe from inertial frame. And in this question it is also given that we have to find a force that is directed towards the center. It means we are talking about centripetal force, and in this situation centripetal force is acting, this is tension. Clear? So we can see a force that is acting towards center along radius, we have here, this is tension, and this tension is actually centripetal force. Clear? So this is all about this question. Now we are going to discuss question number 5.5, and in this question it is given to you, a constant retarding force of 15 Newton is applied on a body of mass 20 kilogram. Clear? So now let's suppose, let's suppose this is a ground. Clear? And let's suppose we have a body. Let's suppose this is a body. Clear? Mass of this body is given to you, m equal to 20 kg, and it is also given a constant retarding force is acting. So definitely, let's suppose we are assuming this body is going in a right direction. So this retarding force is acting definitely in opposite direction, and this is 15 Newton. Clear? And it is going initially with a speed 15 meter per second. Now what is our objective? Our objective in this question is to calculate total time taken by this body to come at rest. It means it is clear final velocity it should be equal to 0. Now listen carefully. Now you can see here mass of a body is fixed. Clear? And definitely one force this is acting on this body is 15 Newton. So I can write like this, F equal to M into A, mass into acceleration. Force is given here, this is 50, 20 A. So from here we can say A equal to 2.5 meter per second square. Now keep in mind, this acceleration is acting is in opposite direction of a motion. It means this is not an acceleration, this is retardation. Clear? So now you can see here we have constant acceleration. It means I can apply equation of motion, v equal to u plus at. Clear? So final velocity is given to you, this is 0. Okay, what is initial velocity? Initial velocity is given, this is 15 plus acceleration. Actually here we do not have acceleration, here we have retardation. Clear? And we can say this is time. Clear? So from here can we calculate value of t? Yes, 15, this is given by 2.5 times of t. So from here you can say, we can write like this, 15 equal to, this is 5 by 2 multiply t. We can say this is t. So from here we can say total time taken by this body to come at rest, this is equal to 6 seconds. Clear? So from here we can say total time taken, this is equal to 6 seconds. Clear? So this is all about this question. Now dear student, we are going to solve question number 5.6, and in this question it is given to you a constant force acting on a body of mass 3 kg. Clear? So it is given to you, let's suppose here we have, this is ground, let's suppose this is a body and we are applying a constant force on this body. Clear? So constant force I am applying and the mass of this body is given to you 3 kg. Clear? So 3 kilogram mass is given of this body, constant force is acting, as it changes its speed from 2 meter per second to 3.5 meter per second. It means initial velocity given 2 meter per second and final velocity is given 3.5 meter per second. Clear? Now important part is here, it is given constant force is acting. It means we can say this is equal to mass into acceleration. Clear? So now we can say Force is given to you? No. Clear? So it is given here, total time taken to change its speed from u to v, this is 25 seconds. Clear? Because force is a constant, definitely acceleration will be constant. So I can apply here v equal to u plus at. Clear? So from here I can see value of v, this is 3.5, this is equal to 2 plus a, and total time taken is 25 seconds. Clear? So we can say 25a, this should be equal to 1.5. Clear? So value of acceleration, this is given to you, 1.5 divided by 25. So we can say this is 15 by 25 into 1 by 10. From here we can say this is 3 and this one is 5. Clear? So I can say this is 0.6 divided by 10 and this is 0.06 meter per second square. Clear? Now what is our objective? Our objective in this question is to calculate value of a force and the direction also. Clear? So first I am going to solve magnitude of a force. Mass is given 3 and we can say 0.06 meter per second square. This is given to you. Clear to everyone? Yes, correct. Clear? So from here we can say total force we are getting, this is 0.18 Newton. Clear? And what about the direction? So definitely we can say the direction of this force in that direction, because velocity is increasing. Listen carefully. It may be possibility that this force may also act in an opposite direction. But you can see, because velocity of this body is increasing, it means we can say the force is acting in the direction of motion of this body. Clear? So this is all about this question. Now we are going to solve question number 5.7. And in this question it is given, on a body having mass 5 kg, two forces are acting in mutually perpendicular direction, that is 8 Newton and 6 Newton. Now we have to find that magnitude, or we can say direction of acceleration of a body. Clear? So let's suppose, if I am assuming here, let's suppose this is a body. Clear? On this body, mass is given to you 5 kg. Clear? Two forces are acting. Let's suppose in this direction force is acting 8 Newton. And let's suppose in this direction force is acting, this is 6 Newton. Clear? Now we have to find magnitude and direction of acceleration of a body. Clear? So now if we talk about magnitude, definitely we can say two forces are acting on a body and both are perpendicular to each other. So how can we calculate net force? I can say this is equal to under root of F1 square plus F2 square plus twice F1 F2, and angle between these two vectors, we can say this is 90 degree. Clear? So we can say this is 90 degree. Clear to everyone? So now we can write like this, because cos 90 is equal to 0, so this is equal to F1 square plus F2 square, F1 square plus F2 square. So value of F1, this is 8 Newton, and F2 value is 6 Newton. So 8 square plus 6 square, this should be equal to, we can say 64 plus 36, this is equal to 100, and we can say this is equal to 10 Newton. Clear? So now we can say net force, this is acting on this body, is 10 Newton. Clear? Okay. Now our objective here in this question is to calculate direction also. So definitely we can say, if we compare magnitude of individual forces, this is 8 Newton. So definitely resultant will be tilted towards this 8 Newton. Yes, it means I can say, let's suppose this is value of net force. Clear? And let's suppose I am saying this angle is theta. Clear? So can I calculate here value of 10 theta? Yes. Value of 10 theta, this is given by, we can say perpendicular upon base. Perpendicular we have 6. We can say this is 8. Clear? So now we can say tan of theta, this is given by 3 by 4. Clear? And we can say, because this is 3 by 4, it means we can say this is 10, 30, 7. Clear? So we can say angle theta, this is given by 37 degree. Clear? It means net force acting on this body is at an angle 37 degree with 8 Newton force. Clear? But in this question, our objective is to calculate acceleration of a body. So I can say acceleration is given by net force divided by mass. Net force we have 10 divided by 5. So 10 divided by 5, this is equal to 2 meter per second square. And what about direction of an acceleration? We can say direction of acceleration is the same as the direction of net force. Clear? So we can say correct answer, this is 2 meter per second square. Clear to everyone? Now we are going to discuss question number 5.8. And in this question it is given to you, the driver of a three-wheeler moving with a speed of 36 km per hour see a child standing in the middle of the road and bring his vehicle to rest in 4 seconds just in time to save the child. Clear? So, now listen carefully. What is the given situation? Let's suppose this is a three-wheeler. You can assume this is a three-wheeler. Clear? And let's suppose here we have a small child. Clear? And this small child is actually standing in the middle of a road. I don't know why. But the driver of a three-wheeler moving with the speed 36 km per hour. So let's suppose this is moving 36 km per hour. You can convert this into meter per second. So I can say this is 36 into 5 by 18. So I can say this is 10 meter per second. Fine. See a child standing in middle and bring his vehicle to rest in 4 seconds. So time is given to you 4 seconds. Clear? It means we can say initial velocity or initial speed we have 10 meter per second. And what is final speed? We can say final speed is 0. Clear? So can I apply here equation of motion? Sure. V equal to u plus at. Final velocity we have 0. Initial is given to you 10 plus acceleration. I don't know. But what about time taken? This is 4. So from here you can say acceleration I will get minus 2.5 meter per second square. This minus value of acceleration indicating that this acceleration is acting in the opposite direction of motion. Definitely we can say when driver see this child, definitely driver applies some brake, friction force is acting in an opposite direction. So definitely this is a retardation. Clear? Now, what is second part? What is average retarding force acting on a vehicle? Clear? So I can write like this. Average retarding force, I can say total mass, and we can see this retarding acceleration, or we can say retardation. Clear? Now if we talk about total mass, we can say mass of a three-wheeler is given to you 400 kg and mass of a driver is 65 kg. So what is total mass? Definitely the driver is sitting in a three-wheeler. So total mass I can say this is 465 and retardation we can say 2.5. Clear? Or you can easily solve this question. 465 divided by, we can say 5 by 2. Clear? First multiply. We can say this is 25, we have 32, we have 3. So this one divide by 2. So from here we can say 1. Again we have 1. Clear? We can say 6. We have 2.5. So from here you can say average retarding force acting. This is given by 1162.5 Newton. Clear to everyone? Yes or no? Yes. So this is all about this question. Now we are going to solve question number 5.9. And in this question it is given to you. A rocket with a lift of mass 20,000 kilogram is blasted upward with an initial acceleration of 5 meter per second square. Calculate the initial thrust, or we can say force of the blast. Clear? So let us try to analyze this given situation. Let's suppose this is a rocket. Clear? Mass is given to you. Let's suppose I am assuming this is capital M. Clear? This rocket is having some initial acceleration A in an upward direction. So definitely let's suppose I am saying thrust force is acting. This is force F. Actually what is thrust? Definitely some gas is to be, some blunt gases, it will be come out from this rocket in a downward direction. According to Newton's third law, we know every action has an opposite reaction. So definitely if burning gases, we can say this is an action. So we can say upthrust that is acting. This is known as reaction. Clear? So we can say let's suppose thrust force is F. Because it is having some mass, so definitely gravitational force is also acting in the downward direction. So I can write like this. Net force, this is equal to mass into acceleration. Clear? Net force is acting in upward direction. I can say this is F minus mg. This is equal to ma. Clear? So I can say value of F, this is given by m times g plus a. Now mass of this rocket, lift of mass, actually we know as the rocket will move in an upward direction, definitely the mass will also change. Clear? So actually this is a variable mass problem, but because that's why it is written here lift of mass. Initial mass is given to you 20,000. So I am writing here this is 20,000 and this is 10 plus. If we talk about acceleration, we can say this is 5. Clear? This is given in a question. So from here we can say 20,000, this is multiplied with 15, so I can say this is 30 into, we can say this is 10 to the power 4 Newton. Clear? So I can say thrust force acting in vertical upward direction, this is given by 3 into 10 to the power 5 Newton. Clear to everyone? So this is all about this question. Now dear student, we are going to solve question number 5.10. So hope you are enjoying all these questions. So question number 5.10. In this question, it is given to you a body of mass 0.40 kilogram moving initially with a constant speed of 10 meter per second to the north. Clear? So first, let us try to draw one rough diagram so that we can get the clarity of all the concept. So let's suppose I am taking this direction as north direction and this direction we have south. Clear? A body of mass 0.4 kg moving initially with constant speed to the north. So let's suppose I am saying this is a body, clear? And let's suppose this body is going initially in this direction. U is given to you 10 meter per second, clear? Mass is also given. This is equal to 0.4 kilogram. Fine, clear? It is also given north is subjected to a constant force 8 Newton directed towards south. Okay, so we can see force is acting in this direction. This is the force acting and in this direction, and force value is given. This is 8 of Newton. Clear? And it is acting for t equal to 30 seconds. Clear to you? Now listen carefully. Our objective in this question is to calculate position at time t equal to minus 5, 25 seconds and 100 seconds, but we have to take force is applied to be t equal to 0 at the position x equal to 0. So let's suppose we are taking this origin as our reference. At time we have t equal to 0 and x equal to 0. Clear? Now first our objective here is to calculate position of this body at time t equal to minus 5 seconds. Now you know that time it can never be negative. Clear? So when time is not negative, how we will calculate this question? So definitely we can say at t equal to 0 when the particle is at origin, so at t equal to minus 5, it means particle is at rest, yes or no? Or we can say moving with initially constant speed, yes. So we can see at time t equal to minus 5 second, clear? So initially it is having constant speed, so before that we can observe constant speed, so we can say x equal to vt, clear? Now initial velocity is given, let's suppose I am taking upward direction positive. I am taking here upward direction positive, clear? So this is 10 and I can take here value, this is minus 5. So value of x we will get, this is minus 50 meter, clear? So if you are talking about at time t equal to minus 5, position is given by minus 50 meter, clear? Now if we talk about position of this particle at t equal to, we can say 25 second. Now listen carefully. You can observe the force is acting in the opposite direction of a motion. Clear? So definitely we can say this initial speed is slowly decreases, and definitely particle will reach up to a point where its velocity becomes zero, and after that it will take a U-turn. Clear? So, but our objective in this question is to just calculate position. It means our objective is to calculate only displacement. So we can apply here this formula, s equal to ut plus half of at square. Why I am applying this formula? Because you know, force is acting here, mass is also given to you. So can we find here acceleration? Yes, f divided by m. F is given 8, mass is given, this is 0.4. So I can say this is 2 by 5. So 5 multiply 8 by 2. I can say this is 4, so this value we have 20 meter per second square. Because in this question it is given that constant force is acting up to 30 second. It means at t equal to 25 second, particle is having a uniform retardation. Clear? So it means I can apply this equation of motion. So I can say s value u. I am taking here upper direction positive, so initial velocity we have 10 and total time if we talk about time, we have this is 25 second plus I can say 1 by 2 value of acceleration, this is minus 20, clear? And we can say time square means 25 whole square, clear? So from here we can say this is 250 minus 10 multiply, we can say 625, clear? So I can write like this, this is 250 minus 6250. So from here you can say this is minus 6000, or I can say this is minus 6 kilometer, clear? So at time t equal to 25, the particle will be at a position minus 6 kilometer. Minus 6 kilometer means what? Definitely from this reference, 6 kilometer in downward direction. Clear to everyone? So this is all about part number B. Clear? Now let us try to understand last situation. We have to find position of a particle at time t equal to 100 second. Clear? So at time t equal to 100 second. Now listen carefully. It is given in a question, the force is acting only up to 30 second. So what will happen for rest 70 second? For rest of 70 second, particle will move with a constant velocity. Clear? So first I will find here position of a particle at t equal to 30 second. I can say, I can write like this, ut plus half of at square. Clear? Initial velocity I can take positive. We can say this is 30 plus 1 by 2. This is minus 20 and this is 30 square. Clear? So we can say this is 300 minus 10 multiply, this is 900. Clear? I can say this is 30 into 30. Clear? So from here I can say this is 300 minus, I can say 900, this is 9000. Clear? So I can say this is minus 8700 meter. Clear? But this is a displacement of that particle, or this position of a particle up to 30 seconds. Clear? So first we will calculate speed, or we can say velocity of a particle at time t equal to 30 seconds. Clear? So I can now write like this. Velocity is given by u plus at. Clear? This we have 10 plus. This is minus this one. And we can say this is 30. Clear? So we can say this is minus 600. From here you can say this is 590 meter per second. Clear? It means we can say now for the next 70 second, this particle will move with constant velocity. So now I can see, I can write like this, distance covered in next 70 second. Next 70 second, this is given by, I can say, speed into total time, x equal to ut. Yes or no? Yes or no? So we can say this is 70. So if you multiply, I can say this 0, 0. We can say this is 3, we have 6. And we can say 4, 1, 3, 0, 0. Yes or no? And here we have minus also in meter. Clear? So what is the position of a particle at time t equal to 100 second? So position of a particle at time t equal to 100, this is given by position initially 30 second, this is minus 8700, and in the next 70 second we can say 41300. Clear? So now we can calculate 00, we can say again 0, we have this one, and this is minus 50,000 meter. Clear? Or you can say this is equal to minus 50 kilometer. Clear to everyone? So like this you can calculate value of net, we can calculate position of a particle at different time. Clear to everyone? So I think definitely there are so many concept is there in this question. So I think you got the clarity of concept. Clear? So this is all about this question. Now dear student, we are going to solve question number 5.11. In this question it is given, a truck start from rest and accelerate uniformly at 2 meter per second square. So let's suppose I am taking situation like this. Let's suppose here we have a truck. Let's suppose this is truck. Clear? In this question it is given, it is start from rest. It means u is given to you 0 meter per second. And it is also given acceleration is uniform. Means acceleration is given by 2 meter per second square. Clear? At time t equal to 10 second, a stone is dropped by a person. So let's suppose now situation becomes like this. Let's suppose this is truck, and on this truck let's suppose we have this person. Clear? Now let's suppose this person is having a stone. Clear? Now in this question it is given after t equal to 10 second. Clear? After t equal to 10 second, this person is dropping a stone and this person is standing on the top of a truck. Okay. What are the velocity and acceleration of stone at t equal to 11 second? So first, whenever person is releasing this we can say stone at the time, because after 10 seconds he is releasing, it means definitely this stone is having both velocities. Clear? We can say horizontal velocity as well as the vertical velocity. So first we can calculate velocity of a truck after time t equal to 10 seconds. Let's suppose I am saying this is v. So v equal to u plus at. I can say this is 0, acceleration is 2, and we can talk about this is 10. Clear? So I can say this is 20 meter per second. Clear? So I can say this truck is actually moving with velocity 20 meter per second after 10 seconds. Clear? Now what is happening as this stone is releasing? Listen carefully. Let's suppose stone reaches up to this point. When stone is releasing, two velocities are acting here. This is Vx equal to 20 meter per second. As this stone is separated from this truck, it will have a constant velocity in horizontal direction. But what about the vertical velocity? It is given we have to find velocity at t equal to 11 second. So here we have to calculate vertical velocity after 10 second. 10 second means we can say 10 second and 11 second. So for the 1 second, what is velocity attained by this stone? Clear? So we can say, yes, so we can see v equal to u. So initial velocity in vertical direction we have 0 plus. I can see I am taking downward direction positive. So acceleration due to gravity we have 10, and total time duration we have, this is 1 second from 10 second to 11 second. Clear? So vy we can say this is equal to 10 meter per second. Clear? So how can I calculate resultant velocity? Clear? So I can say resultant velocity is calculated by v equal to under root of vx square plus vy square. Clear? Under root of vx square plus vy square. Vx square is given to you 20 square plus this is 10 square. Clear? So I can say this is 500. So this is equal to under root of 500 and this is equal to 10 root 5. Clear? 10 root 5 and this is meter per second. Clear? So this is resultant velocity of this stone at 11 second. Clear? But what about acceleration? Clear? So if we talk about acceleration part, as this stone is detached from this truck, clear, at the time we can say there is no acceleration in a horizontal direction. We always find acceleration in a vertical direction, and we can say in this case we have acceleration, that is g meter per second square, and this is in vertically downward direction. So I can say this is vertically downward direction. Vertically downward direction. Clear to everyone? So this is all about this question. Now we are going to discuss question number 5.12, and in this question it is given to you a bob of mass 0.1 kilogram hung from the ceiling of a room by a string 2 meter long. Clear? So concentrate. Let's suppose we are taking here, let's suppose this is a bob having mass m, this is equal to 0.1 kilogram. Clear? And it is hung from this string. So we can say this length of this string is given to you 2 meter. Clear? It is set into oscillation. Okay, fine. The speed of the bob at its mean point is 1 meter per second. Clear? So let's suppose we set this bob in an oscillation. Let's suppose here this is extreme position. I am saying to you this is extreme position. Clear? Like this. Clear? Now, speed of a bob at its mean position. So we can say this is known as the mean position. So at mean position, speed is given to you 1 meter per second. This is given. Okay, fine. And what is trajectory of a bob if a string is cut? when the bob is number one at one of its extreme position. Now listen carefully. We know this is extreme position. This one is also an extreme position. So at extreme position, as this bob reaches to extreme position, we cut this thread. Clear? At the time you can see at extreme position you can find speed this is equal to zero. So when we have speed zero and we cut this thread, definitely this is just case of a free fall. Clear? It means we can see here this bob will actually move in a vertically downward direction, and we can say here we will have acceleration due to gravity come into picture. Clear? So if we are talking about trajectory, definitely at the extreme position, if you are cutting string, we can say this bob will move in a motion in a straight line. Clear? So part A, we can say trajectory. Trajectory means what? Trajectory means we can say the particle is following which path. Clear? So we can say here we have a trajectory of motion in a straight line. Motion in a straight line. Clear? And what is happening at mean position? Clear? So at the mean position, what we can see? We can see at mean position. Now let us try to understand. Let's suppose this bob is at mean position and I am cutting this string. At the time we can see at the bob we have this velocity, horizontal velocity. Clear? As well as I can say as I cut string, definitely a force will act in a vertically downward direction, and we can say acceleration due to gravity. Clear? So definitely we know this is just a case of a projectile thrown parallel to horizontal. Clear? It means we can say in the case number 2, this bob will move, actually follow the parabolic trajectory. Clear? So I can say here at its mean position, we can say it follows parabolic trajectory. It follows parabolic trajectory. Clear to everyone? So we can say this is all about this question, and here we can say in second case, this bob is following parabolic trajectory. Clear? Now dear student, we are going to solve this question, question number 5.13. And in this question, it is given to you a mass of 70 kg. A man of mass 70 kg stand on a weighing scale in a lift which is moving. Clear? So let's suppose if I draw first a lift. So let's suppose this is a lift. Clear? And let's suppose here we have a weighing machine. A man is standing on this weighing machine. Clear? This is given in a question. Mass of a person is given to you. Mass, this is given 70 kg. Clear? Now in first situation, this lift is moving with a uniform speed of 10 meter per second. So it is given V equal to 10 meter per second. Clear? Because this lift is moving in an upward direction with a constant velocity, we can say acceleration is zero. So now we can say force, this is acting on this person, that is the weight, and we can say a normal reaction that is exerted by the lift. Clear? So I can write like this, R minus W, this should be equal to, I can say mass of that person, and we can say acceleration zero. Because lift is going with a uniform velocity, this person is also going with uniform velocity. So I can say, if we talk about reaction, so reaction actually provides you apparent weight. So in this situation, actually this person feels actual weight. Clear? And the weighing machine will tell the total weight. This is, we can see, weight is given by mg. Clear? So I can say this is mg, and we can say this is 70g. Clear? Or let's suppose if I am taking value g, 10 meter per second square, I can say this value is 700 newton. Clear everyone? Yes. Now listen carefully. If I talk about part number B, in part number B, it is given to you, lift is moving downward with uniform acceleration 5 meter per second square. Now acceleration in downward direction. Clear? Now it depends on you. If you are observing from inertial frame, you can write net force equal to mass into acceleration. Or if you are observing from non-inertial frame, at that time a pseudo force will come into picture. Clear? So let's suppose if I write here, from inertial frame of reference, net force equal to mass into acceleration. Clear? Now we can see what is net force, W minus R, because This lift is going in a downward direction, and I can say this is 70 and multiply acceleration A. Clear? So I can say R, this is given by W minus 70 A W. Now we can say W, we can say this is mg, so this is 70 g minus 70 A. Clear? So apparent weight is given by 70 common. Clear? And I can say this is g minus a. So 70 10 minus, here acceleration is given to you 5, so we can say 70 multiply 5, and this is 350 newton. Clear everyone? This is 350 newton. Clear? So now we can say here apparent weight that is observed by this person, this is 350 newton, or you can say on this weighing scale reading that is observed, this is 350 newton. Clear everyone? Yes. Now if I talk about part number C, in part number C it is given, let's suppose this lift is moving upward with a uniform acceleration 5 meter per second square. So let's suppose I am saying acceleration is 5 meter per second square. Clear? So I can say now if I write here equation, I can say this is R minus W, this should be equal to 70 times of acceleration A. Clear? So from here you can see R, this is given by W plus 70 A. Clear? Okay, W is what? Self-weight. Self-weight is given by 70 common, this is G plus A. Clear? So I can say 70, 10 plus 5, we can say 70 multiply 15. Yes or no? So from here we can say this is 1050 newton. Clear everyone? So we can say this is the reading of weighing scale. Clear? Clear everyone? So I think part number A, B and C all are clear to you. Clear? Okay, one more part is given. One more part is given to you here. Now let's suppose some uncertainties happened, and let's suppose lift mechanism is failed, and at that time let's suppose this lift is moving as a free fall, or we can say it is moving under the influence of gravity only. So at that time we can say it is going in a downward direction with acceleration, this is g. Clear? Now you can write like this, W minus R, this should be equal to 70 multiply acceleration, and acceleration is equal to g. Clear? So I can say value of R, this is given by W minus 70 g. Clear? So W we know, this is also 70 g, this is 70 g. I can say weighing scale is saying this is the value 0 newton. Actually this is a condition of weightlessness. Clear? I can say this is a condition of weightlessness. Clear? Weightless condition, you will find, you will feel that you have no weight, but actually this is not. Why? Because lift is actually moving with some acceleration due to gravity, and you also, actually your weight is also due to acceleration due to gravity. So you will find here apparent weight is equal to 0. Clear? So this is all about this question. Now dear student, we are going to discuss question number 5.14, and in this question it is given to you, figure shows the position time graph of a particle of mass 4 kg. What is the, number 1, force on the particle for t less than 0 and t greater than 4 seconds. Clear? And t from 0 to 4 seconds. Clear? Now listen carefully. In this situation you can see, whenever we are talking about, first try to observe this graph. If we are talking about t less than 0, so in t less than 0 we are saying position is actually constant, or we can say position of a particle is not changing. When position is constant, it means we can say here we have velocity 0. Velocity 0, automatically we can say acceleration is 0. If we talk about t greater than 4 seconds, so in t greater than 4 seconds, I can say here again we have position is not changing with time, it means we can say velocity is 0, acceleration is 0. It means if I say for part A, t less than 0, and if I am talking about t greater than 4 seconds, I can directly say net force acting on a particle, this is equal to 0 newton. Clear to you? Now what about from 0 to 4 seconds? So if I talk about time 0 to 4 seconds, listen carefully, position is actually changing linearly with time. It means we have a uniform motion. Clear? And you can easily calculate velocity. How can you calculate? Now we know, because this is x-ray graph, So slope of XT graph, it provides to you velocity, clear? So what is the coordinate of this point? We can say 4, 3, and here we have 0, 0. So we can find here slope. This is slope of XT graph, clear? So slope of XT graph, this is given by, we can say y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1, and this is 3/4 m/s. Now you can say you are getting here velocity, this is a constant, clear? It is not varying with time, clear? So it means we can say acceleration is again 0. So I can see here net force, you will always find mass into acceleration, acceleration 0. So this one is also 0. So we can say 0 Newton. Clear everyone? So I think part number A is clear to you. Clear? Now we have to find what is impulse at t equal to 0 and 4 seconds. Clear? So now concentrate on a screen. Now if I talk about part number B, clear? We have to calculate impulse at 4 seconds. So now we know impulse. Impulse is actually defined as change in momentum. Change in momentum. Clear? And we can say this is equal to mass. I can say this is V final minus V initial. Clear? Now listen carefully. Mass is given to you 4. Important part. First, I am saying what is impulse at time t equal to 0. Clear? Impulse at t equal to 0. Now listen carefully. If we talk about t equal to 0, so before t equal to 0, I can say velocity is 0, and after t equal to 0, we can say velocity we have 3/4 m/s. Yes or no? Clear to you? So we can say final velocity we have 3/4, initial velocity we have 0. We are talking about t equal to 0, means before t equal to 0, we have initial velocity 0 and final velocity 3/4 m/s. So from here we can say this is 3 and kg/m/s. Clear? So this is value of impulse at t equal to 0 seconds. Clear everyone? Now, what will happen at t equal to 4 seconds? Clear? So this is all about t equal to 0 seconds. Clear? Now I am going to discuss at t equal to 4 second. At t equal to 4 second. Clear? So at t equal to 4 second, you can see we have point this one. So before t equal to 4 second, we have velocity. Initial velocity I can say 3/4 m/s. And after t equal to 4 second, because position is not changing, so we can see v final is 0. Clear? It means I can see impulse. This is given by m v final minus v initial. Clear? So mass is given to you 4 kg. So this one is 4 kg. V final is given 0. And v initial is given to you. This is 3/4. So from here you can say this is -3 kg/m/s. Clear to everyone? So like this we can calculate impulse. Clear? So this is all about this question. Now dear student, we are going to solve question number 5.15. And in this question, it is given to you, two bodies of masses 10 kg and 20 kg are kept on a smooth horizontal surface tied to the end of a light string. Clear? So this is a given situation. Let's suppose here we have a horizontal surface. Clear? Let's suppose we are placing, this is 20 kg block, this is 20 kg, and we can say here we have block of 10 kg. Clear? Now we can say both blocks are connected with a light string. Let's suppose this is connected like this. Now a horizontal force is applied to, in first case on A, another case on B. Clear? Now we have to find what is tension in a string. Clear? So first I am taking here case number 1, when I am exerted force on this 10 kg. So I can say here force is exerted 600 Newton. Clear? So how can we solve this question? Actually, we have two methods. Either we have to draw the free body diagram of each block, or first, because it is given here, this surface is perfectly smooth. Clear? So what I can do first, I can assume this as my system. Clear? So I can write like this, net force, this is acting equal to total mass over acceleration A. So let's suppose this system is going with some acceleration A. Clear? So net force, I can say this is 600 equal to total mass of a system 10 plus 20, I can say 30 kg and acceleration is A. Clear? So from here we can say acceleration is given 20 meter per second square. Clear everyone? Now, if we draw here the free body diagram, so we can say force acting on a 10 kg in right direction. Let's suppose tension is T1, here we have tension T1. Clear? Now let's suppose if I just consider free body diagram of 20 kg, I can say this is 20. Let's suppose acceleration in this direction is A1 and tension is acting, this is T1. So from here we can say tension T1, this is given by 20 times of A1. Clear? Okay, value of A1, or you can say value of A. Clear? So value of A, this is equal to 20, acceleration is 20, so I can say we have tension 400 Newton. Clear? Now you can say, sir, if we draw free body diagram of this 10 kg, the answer will come out to be same. Yes. So let's suppose if I am drawing here, this is 10 kilogram body and force acting in this direction, we have 600 Newton. Clear? Let's suppose tension is acting here, this is T1, and acceleration in right direction. So you can write like this, 600 minus T1, this is equal to 10 times of A. Clear? Acceleration value we have, this is 20 meter per second square. So how can I write? I can write like this, 600 minus T1, this should be equal to 10 and this is 20. Clear? From here we can say this is 600 minus 200 and this value we have 400 Newton. Clear? So we are getting same value. Clear? Now I am actually discussing about a second situation. Clear? So in second situation it is given to you. Let's suppose I am assuming here this is 20 kg block. Clear? It is connected with a string and let's suppose here we have 10 kg block. Now in this situation it is given force is acting on this block and this is 600 Newton. Clear? Now let's suppose tension acting, this is T2, this one is T2, and let's suppose I am assuming this whole system is moving with acceleration, let's suppose A, in left direction. Clear? So I can write like this, F net, this is equal to total mass into combined acceleration, let's suppose A. So net force is given 600, total mass we have 30 and multiplied with acceleration A. Clear? So acceleration A, this is given by 20 meter per second square. Clear? Now our objective in this question is to calculate tension in a string. So now we can draw here a free body diagram of both the blocks. So let's suppose I am drawing here free body diagram for 10 kg block. Clear? So for 10 kg block, I can see T2 is acting in this direction, acceleration in this direction. So I can say T2 equal to 10 times of acceleration A. Clear? Acceleration value, this is given to you 20. So we can say this is 200 Newton. Clear? Now let's suppose any student can say, sir, can we find this same answer from 20 kg block? Yes, I can say, let's suppose this is 20 kg. Clear? External force is acting 600 Newton. Clear? Here we have tension T2 and we can see acceleration is acting in left direction. So I can see, I can write like this, 600 minus T2 and this should be equal to 20 multiply A. Acceleration is given, that is 20 meter per second square. So T2 equal to 600 minus 20 multiply 20. Clear? This value we have 400. So I can say this is 200 Newton. So either you are using any free body diagram, you can easily get value of tension. Clear? So my dear student, this is all about this question. Now dear student, we are going to solve question number 5.16. And in this question, it is given to you two masses, 8 kilogram and 12 kilogram, are connected at the two ends of a light inextensible string that goes over a frictionless pulley. Find the acceleration of masses and tension on the string when masses are released. Clear? So first let us try to understand this given situation. Clear? Let's suppose I am saying to you, let's suppose this is a fixed end, and let's suppose we connect here a pulley. Clear, this is a pulley. This pulley is very light, and let's suppose we are connecting here strings. Clear, and let's suppose first I am taking here values in the form of variables. Let's suppose here we have two masses, M1 and M2, and I am assuming here M2 is greater than M1. Clear, M2 is greater than M1. So definitely we can say this block will move in a downward direction and this will move in an upward direction. Clear, because both are connected with the same string, so we can say both are moving with a common acceleration, that is A. Clear. So now our objective in this question is to calculate acceleration of blocks as well as tension that is acting in a string. Clear. So what we do here, first we will draw here a free body diagram of both the blocks. So now we can draw like this. We can say this is M2G, we can say this is tension T. Clear. And acceleration A is acting in a downward direction. We can say this is equal to M1G. Again we have tension T and acceleration A is acting in upward direction. Clear. Now you can say, sir, how you know? You can assume any direction of acceleration, but because we are assuming M2 is greater than M1, so definitely this M2G will be greater than compared to M1G. Clear. So now I can write here equation of motion. So I can say, actually if I write here equation for M2 mass, I can say M2G minus T, this should be equal to M2A, and let's suppose this is equation number 1. Clear. Similarly we can write equation for M1 mass. I can say this is equal to T minus M1G, this should be equal to M1A, and let's suppose this is equation number 2. Clear. Now you can observe we have two equations and we have two variables. Number one variable we have capital T, and second variable we have acceleration. Clear. So now what we can do, we can add here 1 plus 2. If we add two equation, equation number 1 and equation number 2, I can say T and T, this is cancelled out, and I can write here this is M2G minus M1G, this should be equal to. Now we can take here A common, so acceleration A, I can say this is M1 plus M2. Clear. So I can say acceleration A, this is M2 minus M1 and multiplied with G divided by, we can say this is M1 plus M2. Clear everyone? So acceleration A, this is given by M2 minus M1 multiply G upon M1 plus M2. Clear? So this is a formula you should keep in your mind whenever we are taking this pulley is light and string is inextensible. At the time you can apply this formula, A equal to M2 minus M1 upon M1 plus M2 multiplied with G. Clear everyone? Yes. Now what I can do here, if I put this value of acceleration in any equation, I can calculate value of tension. Clear. So let's suppose if I talk about equation number 2, I can say T, this is given by M1G plus M1A. Clear everyone? Yes or no? So I can say, I can write like this, M1 common, this is G plus A. Clear. Now we can put here value of G, value of A, and now you can take common G. Clear. So I can say this is M1G. I can write here 1 plus, this is M2 minus M1 divided by M1 plus M2. So M2 minus M1 divided by M1 plus M2, and this bracket is closed. Clear. So from here we can see value of tension T. Value of tension T, this is given by M1G. Clear. If I taking here LCM M1 plus M2. Clear. So I can say here we can write M1 plus M2, this is M2 minus M1, so M1 and M1, this is cancelled out. I can say this is twice of M2. Clear. So value of tension T, this is given by twice M1 M2 upon M1 plus M2, and it is multiplied with G. Clear. So actually here we have two formulas, acceleration and the tension. Directly you can put here value of M1 and M2 and you can easily get answer of this question. Clear. So now concentrate on a screen. So first I am calculating here value of acceleration. I can say acceleration is given by M2 minus M1 over m1 plus m2 and it is multiplied with g. Clear? Now, value of m2. Let's suppose I am saying this is m2 and let's suppose this is value for m1. Clear? So, I can write like this. This is 12 minus 8 divided by 12 plus 8 and multiplied with g. Clear? If nothing is given, I am assuming value of g is 10. Clear? So, we can say this is equal to 4 divided by 20 into 10. So, we can say this value we have 5 and this is 2 meter per second square. Clear everyone? Now, next objective in this question is to calculate value of tension. So, value of tension. How can we calculate? Now, we know formula T, capital T equal to twice of m1 m2 upon m1 plus m2 and it is multiplied with g. Now we can put here values of m1 and m2. So 2 times m1 and m2. m1 value 8. So 8 into 12 divided by, we can say 8 plus 12 and it is multiplied with g. This is 10. Clear? So we can say 2 into 8 into 12 divided by 20 and multiplied with 10. This one and this one cancel out. This one is also cancel out. Clear? So from here we can say this is 96 Newton. Clear? So like this we can calculate value of tension also. So this is all about this question. Clear everyone? Now we are going to solve question number 5.17, and in this question it is given to you, a nucleus is at rest in the laboratory frame of reference. Okay, show that if it disintegrates into two smaller nuclei, the product must move in an opposite direction. Clear? So now concentrate on a screen. First of all, let us try to understand what is meaning of laboratory frame of reference. It means we are observing from ground. Clear? So, now let's suppose here we have a nuclei. Let's suppose it is having mass capital M. And let's suppose initially this is at rest. Clear? It is given. Now, let's suppose after some time, it breaks into two parts. Let's suppose this is part number 1 and let's suppose this is part number 2. Clear? Let's suppose I am saying mass is m1, let's suppose mass is m2. Clear? And we know very well m1 plus m2, this is equal to capital M. Clear? Now let's suppose, I don't know in which direction both are going. I am assuming here, let's suppose both are moving in the same direction with velocity v1 and v2. Clear? So, now you can observe here, if we consider both as a system, clear? You can see there is no external force is acting in a horizontal direction. Clear? So, whenever there is no external force acting on any system, we can say linear momentum remains conserved. Clear? How can we say? According to Newton's second law of motion, we can see force acting. This is given by dp by dt. So, whenever there is no external force is acting, at the time we can say this delta P, this always remains 0. It means change in momentum, we will find equal to 0. Or we can say initial momentum equal to final momentum. Clear? So, in this situation, if I write initial momentum, P initial equal to P final. Clear? I can say momentum, linear momentum is given by mass into velocity. It means I can say mass multiply, we can say velocity we have 0. Clear? And this should be equal to, this is what? Final momentum. Final momentum, let's suppose I am assuming this direction is positive. Clear? I can write like this. This is m1 v1 plus this is m2 v2. Clear? So from here we can see this is equal to 0. Clear? So now we can see, let's suppose if I write here v1. So v1 I can say this is minus m2 v2 divided by m1. Now listen very carefully. Now you can see m1 and m2 are the masses. Masses are always positive, and definitely if we are assuming v2, v2 is going in a right direction. So if we are taking v2 positive, definitely this minus sign indicating that v1 is going in just opposite direction of v2. Clear? It means if we assume here direction of v1 in this direction, actually this is wrong. Correct direction of v1, this is this one. Clear everyone? So now we can see two smaller nuclei product, it must move in an opposite direction. Clear? And what concept we will apply here? We are applying here concept, this is conservation of linear momentum. Clear everyone? So this is all about this question. Now dear student, we are going to discuss question number 5.18, and in this question it is given to you, two billiard balls each of mass 0.05 kg moving in opposite direction with speed 6 meter per second collide and rebound with same speed. Fine. What is the impulse imparted to each ball due to the other? Clear? Now let us try to understand this question. Let's suppose I am assuming, this is x-axis. And I am assuming this x-axis is positive direction. Right direction is positive. Clear everyone? Now let's suppose I have here two balls. Let's suppose this is ball number 1 and let's suppose this is ball number 2. In this question it is given two billiard balls each of mass 0.05 kg. So 0.05 kg. This is also 0.05 kg. These balls are moving in opposite direction. Means we can say, let's suppose this is moving in this direction, this one is moving in this direction. They actually collide and rebound with same speed. So we can say, in this direction, this is going with speed 6 meter per second. This is also 6 meter per second. And after collision, what will happen? Let's suppose, let's suppose after collision, we are talking about after collision. So after collision, we can see this ball is moving in an opposite direction. It is given in the question. Clear? Rebound. Rebound means what? From which direction the ball is coming, again going in the same direction. So we can see this is going in this direction. So this is 6 meter per second. And here we can see this is also 6 meter per second. Now our objective in this question is to calculate impulse. Clear? So first, let's suppose here we have ball A. Let's suppose this is ball B. This is ball A and this is ball B. So can we calculate first momentum for ball number A? We can say for ball A. Can we find here initial momentum? Clear? So if I am taking right direction positive, initial momentum I can say this is 0.0. Or I can say this is equal to, let's suppose I am saying here this is M, clear? And let's suppose this is V, clear? So I can write like this, this is MV. And what is final momentum? You can see mass is same, but velocity is opposite. It means I can say this is equal to minus MV, clear? So how can we find impulse that is given to ball A? So I can say impulse, this is given by P final minus P initial. Because impulse is defined as change in momentum, clear? So P final we have, this is minus MV, this is already minus and this is MV, clear? From here you can say this is minus times 2 MV, clear? Now you can put here values. What is value of M? Value of M we have 0.05 and speed value is given 6 meter per second, clear? Now we can say this is 0.1, clear? And we can say minus 0.1 multiply 6. Yes or no? Clear? So from here we can see we are getting here value of impulse. This is equal to minus 0.6 kilogram meter per second. Actually this is impulse what? This is, we can say impulse. We can say this is impulse imparted to ball number A by ball number B. Clear? Samajh mein aaya? Clear? So we can say this is impulse imparted by ball number B to ball number A. Clear? So value we have minus 0.6 kilogram meter per second. Same we calculate for ball number B. So if I calculate for ball B, now we can see what is initial momentum for ball number B. I can see this is equal to M times of minus V. Clear? Because this ball is going in left direction. Clear? What is final momentum? I can say this is M times of V. So we can say impulse. Impulse is given by change in momentum. So we can say this is P final minus P initial. P final we have MV minus MV. So from here we can say this is twice of MV. Clear everyone? So this is value of impulse. Now we can put value of impulse, we can put here value of M, value of V. So from here we can see I is given by 2, value of M we have 0.05 and it is multiplied with 6. Clear? So we can say this is 12 and this is 0.6 and we can say kilogram meter per second. Clear everyone? So like this we can calculate value of impulse. Clear? My dear student, keep in mind this is impulse imparted to ball number B by ball number A. Clear? So we can say this is all about this question. Clear? Now dear student, we are going to discuss question number 5.19, and in this question it is given to you a shell of mass 0.02 kilogram is fired by a gun of mass 100 kilogram. If the muzzle speed of a shell is 80 meter per second, what is the recoil speed of a gun? Clear? So now concentrate. Let's suppose this is a gun. Now you can say, sir, this gun. Yes, you have this much amount of, this is gun. Clear? So let's suppose this is gun. Clear? This is gun. Clear? And let's suppose we are firing a shell from this gun. Let's suppose this is a shell that I am firing, and mass of this shell is given to you 0.020 kg. Clear everyone? Okay. It is fired by a gun of mass, we can say capital M mass, this is given to you 100 kilogram. Fine. If speed of a shell is 80 meter per second, so we can see its speed is given 80 meter per second. Now we have to find what is recoil speed of a gun. Clear? Actually, what we understand by muzzle speed. Muzzle speed means we can say this is velocity of a shell with respect to gun. Clear? Always keep in mind velocity of gun with respect to velocity of a shell with respect to gun. Clear? So now you can actually practically observe. Let's suppose we are firing from this side. Definitely, if ball is actually if shell is going in a right direction, definitely, because according to Newton's third law, we know that every action has an opposite reaction. So if we are assuming this as action, definitely we have a reaction also. Clear? It means we can say that suppose here we have a spring, and from this spring a force is exerted on this shell. Clear? So definitely, if we are assuming this as action, a reaction will act in an opposite direction. So logically I am taking that, let's suppose velocity of a gun or recoil speed of a gun in this direction, that is V. Clear? So now we have to find what is recoil speed of a gun. So initially, let's suppose I am assuming this shell is inside this gun. Clear? And I am assuming this shell and this gun as is one system, and at that time initially both are at rest. So I can say what is initial momentum. I can say capital M plus small m, and we can say both are at rest. Clear? So this is value of initial momentum. Now we can see in horizontal direction there is no external force is acting. What I am saying to you, in an horizontal direction there is no external force is acting. It means I can apply here conservation of linear momentum. So now we can say this is initial momentum. Now how can I write final momentum? I can say this is equal to mv, and I can say this is equal to m, and this is time of minus v. Clear? Let's suppose this is small v. Clear? Now from here you can say I can write like this, capital mv, this should be equal to m times of v. Clear? So now we can say capital mv equal to small m times of v. So capital M is given, this is 100 kilogram, this is v. Clear? Small m is given 0.020, and velocity v, this is given to you 80. Clear? This value we have 80. Clear? So from here we can say value v, this is given by 0.020 into 80 by 100. Clear? From here we can say this is cancelled out. So from we can write like this, value of v, 20 by, we can say this is 1000 into 8 by, we can say 10. We can say this one is cancelled out. Clear? So from here you can say v, this is given by 16 into 10 to the power minus 3 meter per second. Now you can say, sir, this is a very small amount of recoil velocity. Yes. Why this is happening? Because shell is having a very less mass, so its velocity is very high, but gun is having a very large mass. Clear? So if mass is more, definitely the velocity that is imparted, it will be very less. Clear to everyone? So my dear student, this is the recoil speed of a gun. Clear? So this is all about this question. We are going to discuss question number 5.20, and in this question it is given to you a batsman deflect a ball by an angle of 45 degree without changing its initial speed, which is equal to 54 km per hour. Okay, what is impulse imparted to the ball? Clear, mass of a ball is given 0.15 kg. Clear? So, now we can see a batsman deflect a ball by an angle of 45 degree. Clear? Without changing its initial speed. So, let's suppose I am drawing here a bat. Let's suppose this is a cricket bat. Clear? Let's suppose initially ball is coming from this direction and initial speed is given 54 km per hour. So we can convert into meter per second like this, 5/18, and we can say this is what? 3. We can say 15 meter per second. Clear? So let's suppose I am assuming ball is coming from this side to the bat with this velocity 15 meter per second. Now in this question it is given that a batsman deflect a ball by an angle 45 degree without changing its initial speed. So definitely let's suppose in this direction this ball is deflected. Clear? Speed is same. So I am taking, let's suppose this is v2 because direction is changing. Clear? If we are talking about velocity, with velocity magnitude and the direction both are associated. Clear? So I can say this is v2 and we can see this angle is given, this is 45 degree. Clear everyone? This is 45. Okay. So now our objective here in this question is to calculate impulse. Now you know for the impulse we know impulse is equal to change in momentum. Yes or no? So change in momentum means we need a change in velocity. Clear? So from here you can see we can write like this. If we want to find change in velocity is written, that is final velocity minus initial velocity. Yes or no? It means, let's suppose if I draw this this curve in a vector form, how can I draw? Listen carefully. Let's suppose I am saying this is v2. This value we have v2. Clear? Now I am writing here this is minus v1 because this is change in velocity. It means I can see velocity vector of this v1 is changing. So I can say this is v1. Clear? This value we have v2. So resultant velocity is given by this vector. Clear? This is vector v. Clear? So from here we can say, let's suppose this is vector v, or you can say this is change in velocity. Clear? Or let's suppose you can assume this is delta v, so this is delta v. Clear everyone? Now my objective here in this question is to calculate first what is change in velocity. So if I find here magnitude, how I can find? I can calculate magnitude by this formula, v1 square plus v2 square plus 2v1 v2 cos of theta. Clear? So I can say v1 square plus v2 square plus 2v1 v2. Now what is angle between two vectors? We can see v2 and v1. Clear? So definitely we can see here, if we are talking about angle, so if you extend this one, definitely you can say this angle is 45. Clear? So angle between two vectors here we have cos of 45. Clear? So now I can calculate. If I put here values, under root of v1 square, v1 means we can say 15. So we can say this is 15 square plus 15 square plus 2, this is 15, this one is 15, and we can say this is 1/√2. Clear everyone? So now we can say this is given by, we can say this is 2 to 5, plus this one is also 2 to 5 plus, we can say this is 2 to 5 and this one is 450 into 1/√2. Clear? You can also write like this. This is equal to under root of 2 to 5 multiplied 2 plus, this is 225 multiplied 2. So we can say 225 under root 2. Clear? So if you take here common 225, we can say this is equal to 15. So change in velocity in magnitude, this is given by 15 under root of, we can say 2 plus 1.41. Clear? So from here we can say this is 15 multiply 3.41. Clear? So can we calculate and square root of 3.41? Clear? So can we calculate this value under root of 3.41? Clear? Now actually we know, if we talk about 3.41, so 341, we can say near about we have 18 we can say 18 is equal to 324. Yes, 18 square root of 324 we have 18. So it means we can say this is something multiplied 18. So we can say approximately this is 1.8. Clear? So what I'm saying to you, actually you have to take here a simple calculation. So I can say 15 multiply 1.8. Clear? So from here you can say we can say 120. So this is 0. We have so from here we can say resultant velocity or resultant change in velocity we are getting 27 meter per second. Clear to everyone? Yes. But our objective in this question is to calculate impulse imparted. So how can we calculate impulse? I can say impulse imparted, this is given by impulse is given by mass into change in velocity. Clear? Because we are talking about just magnitude, I can say m is given, yes, 0.15, and it is multiplied change in velocity. Change in velocity have 27 meter per second, so this is 27. So from here you can say, I can write like this, into 27. So now we can say 8 127 135, so we can say 5 we have 13 30, so we can say 435 divided by 100. Clear? So from here you can say we are getting value of impulse, this is equal to 4.35, and this one is kilogram, and we can say meter per second. Clear? So this is value of impulse, or we can say this is impulse imparted to the ball by batsman. Clear everyone? So this is all about this question.